On Sunday morning, I've been teaching some on what's called gematria. Gematria is a very complex, if not at least intricate, study of the alphabets of the scripture. Before the alphabet, before the Bible was written, when the alphabet, the Hebrew alphabet and the Greek alphabet were invented or created by man, before this, there was an alphabet that was created. The Hebrew and the Greek alphabets were created before the Bible was written, and to each letter was assigned a numerical value. Now, we teach here at Grace and Truth Ministries that not only that God is a magnificent God in that He redeems man, but also that He has an exact numerical arrangement of all Scripture in the Bible. When the Bible says in John 3:16, "For God so loved the world," when people come up and they say, "Well, if I believed in predestination, I couldn't believe in John 3:16. That proves their free will." No, John 3:16 proves that God's got a magnificent, orderly arrangement for all things, because the word "world" is the word cosmos. Cosmos. And it means an orderly arrangement. It's actually written in the Greek K-O-S-M, this is an M, O-N. Their N looks like our V, and their S in the middle of a word is a little circle with a little flag on top, and their M is an looks like an upside down H. They've got two O's. They've got the Omicron and the Omega. This is the Omicron here. And that is, with changing the word ending, it becomes masculine gender. Now, that word cosmos, a world, in John 3:16 means orderly arrangement. It doesn't mean people, globe, or dust. God did not love everybody in the world. If the Bible says God is an adverb and tells how. Adverbs tell how, when, and where. They modify verbs, adjectives, and other adverbs. And this word, is the word huta, and it means in this fashion. For God so loved, and of loved is A-G-A-P-E, and agape is one of the words for love, but the word we're always thinking of is P-H-I-L-E-O, phileo. That word phileo means to have affection. Have affection. But this word, agape, or agapao, the verb form, it is the relationship that kings had for their subjects, the subjects had for their kings. Over there in 2 John 6, herein is agape, herein is love, that we walk after His commandments. So if you love your neighbor, love your enemy, and when the Bible says God is love, it's always agape, never phileo. God is not affection. He's only affection to those who belong to Him. And He said, "You are my friends," P-H-I-L-I-A, philia, "if you do the things I say, if you walk in my commandments." And of course, philia comes from phileo. I will have affection for you conditionally. There's no such thing as unconditional love. And of course, we've got this word for orderly arrangement. And then Paul said in Acts 13:48, he said, "As many as were ordained to eternal life believed the day that he preached at Antioch." He said, and the word ordained there is T-A-S-S-O, and that word means orderly arrangement. It comes from the word T-A-X-I-S. That word taxis, we get our word T-A-C-T-I-C-A-L, tactical or tact. We're not to use tact. We're to use God's tactical, military, orderly arrangement of all things. That's what we're supposed to do. And there's several words that means an orderly arrangement. Not only has God got everything arranged in an orderly fashion, He's got it. He's got the numbers of Scripture. He has not ordered just a little bit. The Scripture says the steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord, and he delighteth in his way. Though he fall, he shall not be utterly cast down, for the Lord upholdeth him with his hand. And the Scripture also says that he says, "I'm God, there's none else. There's none beside me." There in Isaiah 46:10, he said, declaring the end from the beginning and from ancient times the things that are not yet done, saying, "My counsel shall stand, and I'll do all my pleasure." No one is getting away with anything. Satan is not getting away with anything and beating God. The world is not in a shape that God doesn't want it to be in. He can stop everything right in the middle of where it is. But God not only has arranged everything, He's created in light and darkness. He said, I create light and darkness. I make peace. Or he said, I make light and create darkness. I make peace and create evil. I, the Lord, do all things. But not only did he create evil, he created everything. He created the lives of the men. He created everything to intertwine. We don't just believe predestination. We believe everything that's going on is exactly the will of God. That's why 1 Thessalonians 5:18 says, in everything give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. Everything. Good things, yes. Bad things, yes. And Paul said in Romans 8:28, for we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are the called according to his purpose. God's got an exact purpose for everything. He says, we've obtained an inheritance, Ephesians 1:11, being predestinated according to the purpose of him who worketh all things after the counsel of his own will. Ecclesiastes 3:14, the scripture says, I know that whatsoever God doeth, it shall be forever, and nothing can be put to it, nor anything taken from it, and God doeth it that men should fear before him. We have a magnificent God. Now, I spent the last two nights putting this gematria together. This is not something I got out of a book. This is one of the most, I do get some of my gematria out of a book. But if I use this gematria, which is the study of the numerology of Scripture, of the Greek and the Hebrew language, and the various numerical equivalents that they are given the value, you come up with some exact things. Now, I'm going to tell you why I put this on the board. The reason I started with Adam, and it went all the way through the lineages of Scripture from Adam all the way down to Jacob, whose name was changed to Israel. This is every righteous man in an exact lineage from Adam all the way to Jacob. You've got two sets. You've got two sets of 11 generations. And it's unbelievable how these things match up. Now, God's got this thing, and here's why I put it together. I was studying this right here. I was studying the sons of God. This is the word sons of God in the Old Testament. Ben Elohim. Elohim, Ben means son of, and Elohim is the word God, so this is the word sons of God. Let me pull this out of the way. I'm going to try to explain this to y'all, unless one of y'all want to help me. This is the word sons of God, and it's mentioned seven times in the Old Testament Scripture. Seven times 153 is 1,071. Now, in the 8th chapter of Romans, if you'll turn your Bibles to the 8th chapter of Romans, we'll look at this over here. Go to the 8th chapter of Romans, and Paul says here in the 8th chapter of Romans, in the 17th verse, well, let's read 16 and 17. The Spirit itself beareth witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. And if children, then heirs, and heirs of God, and joint heirs with Christ. Now, joint heirs, when you add up the word joint heirs, this sons of God, this sons of God is mentioned seven times in Scripture, and a son was an heir, and this is the word joint heirs. Sug kleronomoi. Well, when you add up the gematria of sug kleronomoi, it adds up to 1,071, or seven times 153. Now that has particular significance because the heir of a kingdom among the Jews was equal or called the fish. The fish. Now the fish, because the baby was in a womb, was in the womb 40 weeks, four times seven. Four times seven all through Scripture, seven is the number of baptism. Four is the number of God's judgment. Sword, famine, pestilence, and beast. All through the Old Testament Scripture. Of course, God said to Israel in the 26th chapter of Leviticus, He said, I will punish you 7 times for your sin. He said it 4 times. Each time he mentioned it, he'd mention sword, famine, pestilence, beast. Over in the 8th chapter of Mark, Christ fed 4,000 with 7 broken loaves of bread. And that's the number of maturity. For us to mature, the bread has to be broken. And the bread is the church. Paul said, we being many, in 1 Corinthians 10 and 17, we being many are one bread. So we're the bread, we're the air, and we're the fish. The fish is in a lake for 9 months or for 40 sevens. Well, if the fish is the air, one more time, let's go over to the air and let's go look at the fish over in John 21, and this is why I came up with this. Sons of God. Now, let's go over here to, where did I say go? Yeah, John 21. I got so many things going on in my head. Now, John 21 and verse 2. Peter, you got seven of the disciples of Christ here in verse 2. There were together Simon Peter, that's 1. Thomas, called Didymus, is 2. Nathanael is 3. The 2 sons of Zebedee, James and John, and 2 other disciples, that's 7. You had 7 disciples fishing that day. And they go out and throw out the net. And the scripture says in verse 6, and he said unto them, cast the net on the right side of the ship, and ye shall find. They cast therefore, and now they were not able to draw it for the multitude of fishes. Then let's look on down here at verse 11. Simon Peter went up and drew, and the word drew is helko, H-E-L-K-O, H-E-L-K-O. That's the same word as draw in verse 6, and that's the same word as draw in John 6:44. No man can come to me except my Father which has sent me draw him. It's the same word, John 6:44, that's used for the fishermen dragging in their nets. People say, God won't drag people in. Well, since there's none good, not one, none is righteous, none understands, none seeks after God, if he don't drag you in, you're not coming. Jesus said in John 6:37, all that the Father giveth me, all that the Father giveth me shall come to me. And he says in verse 39, of all that the Father hath given me, I should lose nothing. Well, how many fish do the apostles catch that day? Do the 7 disciples of Christ catch? Well, it tells us, Simon Peter went up and drew the net to the land full of great fishes, and 153, 7 disciples fishing for 153 fish. This is no mere incident or accident. God arranged for every fish to swim over there in the exact position. Now, people say, I don't believe in predestination. Predestination is a very small part of this great big picture. Predestination, when you get down to the gematria of the scripture, predestination is actually about kindergarten when you start adding up all the rest of this stuff. Of course, the word predestinate is the word prohorizo in Romans 8:29. For whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate to be conformed to the image of his son. Predestinate, prohorizo, means to pre-bound inside the kingdom where heirs keep the commandment of God. Now, here's why I started studying the gematria from Adam, the righteous lineage of Adam, all the way down to Israel, or Jacob, whose name was changed to Israel. That's because this is the sons of God, right here. This is the righteous lineage. I've got it on a poster board over here, excuse me. I drew up this poster. I need to put it in darker letters. But here's God's son, Adam. And of course, you notice that Cain is not in here. The 5th chapter of Matthew starts off and shows us the lineage of God. Adam had a son, Seth. Seth had Enos. Enos had Canaan, Mahalaleel, Jared, Enoch, Methuselah, Lamech, and Noah, Shem. And all the way down through here. And what I did, I went from here all the way down to Jacob. And we have added up the gematria. It's unbelievable how it adds up. Whew. We have a God that is so magnificent. Now, you don't have to worry about copying that down. You can have a copy of my notes when it's over with, okay? Yeah. You can have my notes. Now, if you can read this last page, you can have it, okay? You can't have this one. You got it. We're making some copies, okay? Now, here's why I begin to study the sons of God. Next week, before next week gets here, I'm going to add up all the sons of Jacob, see what we come up with. We're going to come up with some things. I don't have any doubt. I've never added them before, but I know we're going to come up because I've got all kinds of gematria. Jesus adds up to 888. The word eight means to hear, and I don't even have time to get in that, do I? Let me stop right there. That means to hear. We've got so many things that all this is adding up, and I've got this on paper too, the fellow heirs. And seven times. Now, let me show you why. Let's go over to Genesis, the sixth chapter. Now, sixth chapter Genesis. We'll start through this, and I'm going to just really relax and go through this because this is really a magnificent picture of the great sovereignty of the living God. We know that Jesus performed 153 miracles in Scripture. 153 are recorded. Oh, that's how many times they're recorded. Now, look here in the sixth chapter of Genesis. Verse 1, it came to pass when men began to multiply on the face of the earth, and the daughters were born unto them, that the sons of God, that's that word Ben Elohim, adds up, this word adds up to 153. This word is mentioned, sons of God, is mentioned seven times in the Old Testament. Seven times 153 is 1,071, same as joint heirs, same as sons of God. Now, sons of God saw the daughters of men. There is a pollution of this scripture. People are saying the sons of God were evil angels that fell down from heaven and came down to pollute the lineage of Christ. You don't pollute Christ's lineage by being a tall, evil devil and coming down and intermarrying with women. The Bible says, as the days of Noah were, so shall it also be in the days of the coming of the Son of Man. For as it was in the days of Noah, they were eating, drinking, marrying, and giving in marriage. Giving marriage means to marry two different things together, two things that don't go together. Well, that's what's going on in the world today. Truth has married a lie. That's what this is talking about. We're going to go back to the previous chapter, or the fifth chapter, and the fifth chapter tells you who the sons of God are. It is the lineage of Seth. You can trace Jacob's lineage all the way back through Abraham, up through Shem, up through Noah, all the way back through Methuselah and Enoch and Jared and Mahalalel and Enos and back to Seth, to Adam, to God. But you can't trace Cain's lineage back to but only Adam. Cain was the result of Adam's desire for Eve when he was off in his sin. When God said multiply and replenish the earth, what he had in mind was Abel, not Cain. Cain was the bastard son of Adam and Eve when they came together while they were in their sin. Now, the sons of God saw the daughters of men that they were fair. Where this custom of tall men intermarrying the daughters of men because they were fair, that comes out of Ginsburg's Legends of the Jews. The Jews said that the fallen angels came down from heaven and that they intermarried women to pollute the lineage of the Messiah. And that's where these guys get this today. First of all, you're not a son of God unless you're doing the will of God, are you? Beloved, now are we the sons of God, and it doth not yet appear what we shall be, but we know that when he shall appear, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. Besides that, in the 22nd chapter of Matthew, that in the resurrection we will be like the angels, which neither marry nor are given in marriage. Now, giving in marriage is marrying truth to a lie. The sons of God marrying the daughters of men is the descendants of Seth, which are the sons of God, 153, intermarrying with the unbelieving daughters of Cain, the sun worshipers. If this was tall men, giants, the Jews said they were 300 feet tall. Well, that are in that neighborhood by cubits, that's what they measured out. Well, if that's true, then you've got a skyscraper marrying a woman and cohabitating with her and having children. It's ridiculous, isn't it? It's dumb. No, the sons of God, by definition, can't be fallen angels, because in the second chapter of 2 Peter, the fallen angels are reserved in Tartarus, T-A-R-T-A-R-U-S, Tartarus. That's the only time that word is mentioned in Scripture in the New Testament, Tartarus, and that is the pits of damnation or somewhere in the flames. They're reserved, and that word reserved is T-E-R-E-O, tereo, and that word tereo means to keep unchanged. Well, they can't change their state. They left their first habitation. They can't change their shapes and inhabit the body of a being. That is not true. That's the old ancient vampire demon story and the werewolf story. Those were demons. I don't have time to go there. So they're reserved. And we know that sons of God in Job, the first chapter, is talking about those who have the approval of God upon them. Who is a son? Well, if you look in John 8, you remember John 8? Jesus came to the Pharisees and they said, our father's Abraham. He said, if your father were Abraham, you would do what Abraham said do. He said, your father's not Abraham. He said, your father is the devil. Now, how in the world could the Pharisees, who actually kept the law of God intact, be more unrighteous than fallen angels? I mean, you cannot. Jesus said, your father's the devil. Jehovah's not your father. You're not a son of God, as Pharisees. Anyone who falls and does not do the will of the Father cannot be a son by definition. Besides that, Jesus said, Jesus was the Son of God, wasn't he? And he said, who are my brothers and my sisters there in the third chapter of Mark? Didn't he say that? And what did he answer? He said, is it not those who do the will of the Father? The sons of God are my brothers and sisters, do the will of God. The Pharisees wouldn't do the will of God. He said, your father's the devil. He was a liar and a murderer. Well, then that fallen angels cannot possibly be sons of God by definition. Can they? No. They're sons of Satan. They're messengers of the devil. Now, let's continue here. In the sixth chapter, I'm going to show you this. If, as it was in the days of Noah, so shall it also be in the days of the coming of the Son of Man. They'll be eating, drinking, marrying, and giving in marriage. If the giving in marriage was marrying tall, unbelieving angels to believing women, then it can only be one of two things in the world. It has to be the Watusis marrying godly Christian women, or the NBA marrying Billy Graham's wife, and Shaquille O'Neal is going to run off with Ruth Graham. That's the tallest man in the world. If we're at the end of time, that's what you've got. It's ridiculous. Then you marry or given in marriage. So I was looking at the 153 and I thought, I need to add up some gematria here. And let's do this. Let's finish this right here. And the Lord said, my spirit shall not always strive with man. That's not talking about an invitation hymn and singing just as I am 25 times. How many of y'all heard that used? What he's saying is, I'm not going to fight you. I'll destroy you. That don't have anything to do with just as I am. I'm not going to strive with you. This may be your last chance. There's no such thing as last chance. He's chosen us in him before the foundation of the world that we should be holy and without blame before him in love in Ephesians 1 and 4. And there are vessels of wrath that are fitted to destruction in Romans 9:22. Doesn't the scripture say, hath not the pot of power of the clay of the same lump, verse 21, to make one vessel into honor and another into dishonor, if that's what he wants to do? You don't have a last chance. Now let's read on here. yet his days shall be 120 years. There were giants. That word giant is not, that does not mean tall men. It's the word Nephil, N-E-P-H, N-E-P-H-I-L, Nephil, that's singular, or N-E-P-H-I-L-I-M, or I-Y-M, I-M is plural. That word giant, do you know that Goliath was not called a giant, he was called a champion. This word does not mean tall. This word Nephil or Nephilim means bully or a tyrant. If you want a tyrant, just mix truth with a lie and go to some big Baptist church like the Baptist I was raised around, and you've got a little bit of truth and a whole lot of lie, and those guys are bullies, and you dare not challenge their doctrine. The bullies are here. The giants are here. It's these big pastors, these big churches, and these TV preachers that say, you can't call us down, and you can't change doctrine or challenge us. Well, we see the sons of God, and what happens? Here's what happens. There were giants in the earth, or Nephil, or bullies in the earth in those days. And also, after that, when the sons of God, in the previous chapter, sons of God adds up to 153, mentioned seven times, came in to the daughters of men, and they bare children to them. The same became mighty men, which were of old, men of renown. The word renown. The word renown is the word Shem. Shem was the second born of God. He was God's authority upon the face of the earth. And the word Shem is the word name all the way through the scripture. And the word name doesn't mean J-I-M. That's not my name. My name is my character or my authority. The word name is the word Shem, or it's the word onoma in the Greek, and they mean the same thing. It means a man's authority or his character. If you're going to have a big name in town, you don't have your name, Jim Brown, written in letters 100 feet tall. That means you're going to carry a lot of political clout in the town. So these were men, and when the Bible says that they said, let us build a city and a tower in Genesis 11 and 4, and let us make us a name, they said, let us make us a Shem. Shem is God's prophet. We don't like having to do the will of God. We don't want to crucify. Now let's go back and look at the sons of God in the previous chapter. Let's look at the sons of men. You can only trace Cain back to God. He is not mentioned in the fifth chapter among the sons of God. Let's go back to the fourth chapter. Let's go to the fourth chapter. Let's look at the sons of men. Okay? I'm going to add these up before it's over with. I just don't have time to do all this. Look at verse 16 of the fourth chapter. Here are the sons of men. Son of man means you go back just to man only, and you cannot. You remember over there in the third chapter of Ephesians when Paul said, I am a prisoner of Jesus Christ for you Gentiles, according to the mystery of Christ, which was not revealed in ages past to the sons of men. It wasn't revealed to the Gentiles or the descendants of Cain. That's what we are. Either Cain or Japheth or Ham. We're not descendants of Shem. Shem, we get from Shem. The Jews came from Shem. You get the word Semitic or Semite or Shemite from Shem. Here is the sons of men. Verse 16, Cain went out from the presence of the Lord and dwelt in the land of Nod on the east of Eden. And Cain, this unbeliever, knew his wife, and she conceived and bare Enoch. We have got an Enoch in both lineages in the fifth chapter and the fourth chapter. And he built a city and called the name of the city after the name of his son Enoch. And unto Enoch was born Irad, and Irad begat Mahujael, and Mahujael begat Methusael, and Methusael begat Lamech. You got a Lamech in the fifth chapter among righteous sons. And Lamech took unto him two wives, the name of the one Adah, and the name of the other Zillah. And Adah bare Jabal. He was the father of such as dwell in tents and such as have cattle. And his brother's name was Jubal. He was the father of all as such as handle harp and organ. And we get the word Jubilee from that. And Zilha, she also bare Tubal-Cain, an instructor of every artificer in brass and iron, I'm sure we get the word tuba from that. And the sister of Tubal-Cain was Naamah, and Lamech said unto his wives, Ada and Zillah, hear my voice, ye wives of Lamech, hearken unto my speech, for I have slain a man to my wounding and a young man to my hurt, and this is the lineage of Cain, the sons of men. Now let's look at the sons of God over in the next chapter. In the sixth chapter, we see the lineage of Cain in the fourth chapter marrying the lineage of God in the fifth chapter. But if you'll notice in the fifth chapter, Cain is completely left out of the sons of God. Remember, sons of God, 153. So what prodded me, since sons of God adds up to 153 and it's mentioned seven times, and since joint heirs, our sons, are called the fish, and there were 153 fish caught by seven of the apostles, or seven disciples, then I thought, I need to study the sons of God of the fifth chapter of Genesis, right? So that would only be the only wise thing to do. I'm looking for 153 in this. I believe I'm going to have to add up all the sons of God from Adam all the way through Jesus' lineage in Matthew, the first chapter. And I'm going to do that this week in order to find this. But I've come up with something that's utterly magnificent. And I hadn't got to my 153 yet. This is great. Look here. Look at verse 1. Chapter 5. Here's the sons of God in chapter 5. Marrying the daughters of men of chapter 4, the descendants of Cain. This is the book of the generation of Adam in the day that God created man in the likeness of God made he him. Male and female created he them and blessed them and called their name Adam, which is man. Here's Adam up here. Here's the gematria of Adam right here. It adds up to 45. In the Greek, it adds up to 46. Adam adds up to 46 and man has 46 chromosomes. Now, I don't have time to go back to that. And I don't know what every one of the numbers mean, because nobody does. Now, let's read on. Male and female created he them and blessed them and called their name Adam in the day when they were created. And Adam lived 130 years and begat a son in his own likeness after his image, called his name Seth. Well, Seth means substitute. That's what it means. Seth was the substitute for Abel, whom Cain slew. Let's write that down one more time, okay? We got to see this. Abel, whom Cain slew. Abel was the second born. Remember that? Abel was second born. Cain, firstborn. Firstborn Cain. Slew Abel. And Israel is the firstborn of God. The nation, the scripture says, the Lord told Moses, go to Pharaoh, let my son go, for Israel is my son, even my firstborn. And of course, Israel killed the Holy One, and that's the second born in the flesh, that's Jesus. We're not taking from his deity. He was God from forever. He was eternal God, and he always has been. He was the Word in the beginning. But in the flesh, he is second born, but he's the only begotten, the only one. The word begotten has to be left in John 3:16. Because we're sons of God. If you read your NIV, it says, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son. That's not true. Keep your NIV for corrupt references. Get your King James Bible. King James is not divinely inspired. What's inspired is the Textus Receptus, but we use King James. Because in the King James, we've got all of these word study books, and we go back to the original text. None of the English languages are divinely inspired. They are translations. Now, Cain the firstborn slew Abel. Israel the firstborn slew Jesus. And Adam knew his wife Eve, and she bare a son and called his name Seth in the place, or as a substitute, for Abel whom Cain slew. And God has conceived and brought forth another son in the place of Jesus, whom Israel slew, and that's the church. We are the sons of God. That's what the scripture says. And we take the place of Jesus and continue his work. This is a picture of the church as sons of God here. This is a picture of the church as the sons of God. You've got 11 generations here. This is all the righteous generation of Genesis 11 right here. Genesis 11. Genesis 5. The other is Genesis. This is Genesis 5. And this is the righteous lineage of Genesis 11. Genesis 11. Okay. Now, let's read on. Adam begat Seth. Cain is not there. Even Abel is left out because Abel had a substitute. His name was Seth. So that the custom of a brother marrying his deceased brother's wife started here. You remember when the Lord told Judah told Onan his son to raise up children to his brother, and he refused to do so, and God killed Onan? Well, that's because this is where the custom started. You remember over there in Matthew, the 22nd chapter, when the scripture says when the Sadducees who didn't believe in a resurrection came to Jesus, and they say if a brother marries a woman and he dies, and his brother marries his wife, and he dies, and then they go up to seven brothers who marry their wife in the resurrection, whose wife shall she be? And he said, you do err not knowing the scriptures, for they'll be as the angels which neither marry nor are given in marriage. Angels, fallen or unfallen, do not marry. Besides that, fallen angels can't be called sons of God, can they? No. Because God's sons do his will. To be a son means to participate in the will of a father or in his testament or his testimony. Now, I'm moving over here so you can see this. Now, let's read on. The word Seth means substitute. All the days of Adam after he had begotten Seth were 800, and he begat sons and daughters. And all the days that Adam lived were 930 years, and he died. And Seth lived 5 years and begat Enos. Here's Enos right here. See, this is the sons of God, isn't it? Sons of God has got to have something to do righteous. This is the total gematria of these sons. 45 on Adam. Seth is, wait, look here, 700. Substitute. Wasn't Christ the substitute? Huh? Seven is the number of divine refinement, the number of a blood baptism, isn't it? And when Christ was the substitute, he went through a blood baptism, didn't he? And he called the cross a baptism. And seven is the number of divine refining fire or a blood baptism. Seven times the Ark of the Covenant had to be sprinkled. 70 times seven is the number of divine repentance or the 70 weeks of Daniel. Seven times seven is what the Jews said they had to forgive a man. You've got seven. God tells Israel, I'll punish you seven times for your sins. He says that four times. Naaman had to be dipped seven times in the water. Whenever you die, that's the number seven. That's good, isn't it? I like that. Now, let's go on down the line here. Here's the sons of God. There has to be something righteous in it. Now, all the days that Adam, verse 5, lived were 930 years and he died. And Seth lived 100 years and begat Enos. Enos means mortal. The substitute will be mortal. That's what it'll be, mortal. That's us. This is not a picture of Christ as much as it is us. It would be Christ in you, the hope of glory. And this means substitute. Substitute. Enos means mortal. Let's go on down to Canaan. All right. Seth lived 105 years and begat Enos. And Seth lived after he begat Enos 807 years and begat sons and daughters. And all the days of Seth were 912 years and he died. And Enos lived 90 years and begat Canaan. Now the word Canaan means fixed or dwelling place. It means erect the house. Erect. House. It means a house. Who is the house of God? The mortal substitute for Christ, us. Christ is a son over his own house. Whose house are we? We're the house of God, aren't we? And Christ comes and lives in us, and in him dwells the fullness of the Godhead bodily. There's three in the Godhead, and 3 times 7 is 21. 210. 10 is a righteous number. 100 is a righteous number. 1,000 is a righteous number. Any multiple of that can be reduced back down to the same number without the zeros. 3 times 7 is 21. The Godhead comes and lives in us in the form of Christ when we are baptized 7 times. Now that means erect a house. Erect means upright, doesn't it? And how is the house of God built up? The scripture says charity, and charity is the word agape, and that's walking in God's commandments. Agape edifies. Edifies, the word O-I-K-O-D-O-M-E-O. Oikodomeo, it comes from O-I-K-O-S, that is family or house. And the word domeo, we get the word, it's their word dome, and that is the Greek word for roof. If you're going to build a house, you've got to start with a foundation, with an understanding, a hypostasis, and build upright. And that's what we are with the house of God. We wrecked, we're upright. Now let's go down to Mahalalel, okay? Mahalalel. And Canaan lived 70 years, verse 12, and begat Mahalalel. And Canaan lived. The word Mahalalel means praise of God. That's what we are as the house of God. We're erect and upright. We're mortals and we're the substitute for Christ. So this means praise of God. We are the praise of God. We do not praise ourselves. He that speaketh of himself seeks his own glory. Praise of God. Praise of God. Now, that number adds up to 136. Let's go to Jared. Jared is the sixth. From Jared, we get Jordan. The Jordan is the place of baptism for Jesus, and it's the place of baptism for Naaman, and that's number six. That'll be six. Let's look at Jared. Jared means to descend downward, descent. And they went down into the Jordan. And what happened in the Jordan? They were baptized, and that's what Enoch actually means. But baptized doesn't mean water. If there's one Lord, one faith, one baptism, baptism is blood. He's washed us from our sins in his own blood. The word baptized is the word bapto, and that means to cover with a stain or dye. It has the same meaning, to cover, stain or dye. If Christ has washed us from our sins in his own blood in Revelation 1 and 5, and he has, and there's one baptism, it is a blood, and a blood baptism of the first century was called a death. Jesus said, James, John, can you be baptized with a baptism I'm baptized with? This word bapto or baptized has the same meaning as atonement in the Old Testament, or it has the same meaning as the pitch of the ark, Genesis 6 and 6. Pitch the ark with pitch. Kafar is the word pitch. That's the first word, kafar with kofar. Kofar. Kafar means to cover, kofar means to stain with a dye, and they caulked the boats with something called bitumen. It was a red stained asphalt in its natural state. And Peter said, as 8 souls were saved through water, the like figure, whereunto even baptism doth also now save us. The water wasn't the baptism. The water was the judgment. The baptism was the pitch of the ark. That word kafar, pitch, is the same word as atonement, kafar, and the kaparoth was the mercy seat of the Ark of the Covenant, and they have Yom Kippur, and Yom Kippur is the Day of Atonement. Atonement is the word kafar. So, Enoch. Well, let's read through Jared. I didn't read Jared yet. Let's get back here to verse, where was I, 15? Mahalalel lived 65 years and begat Jared, and Mahalalel lived after he begat Jared 830 years and begat sons and daughters. And all the days of Mahalalel were 895 years, and he died. And Jared, which we get the word Jordan, the word Jared is Yarad, and we get the word Jordan from that. And Jared lived 162 years and begat Enoch. Enoch is the seventh from Adam. Jude, the fourth chapter, says that Enoch was the seventh from Adam. Well, the seventh from Adam is Enoch, and the word Enoch is the word Kanok. It's the word Kanok. It comes from Kanok, means to narrow. wait a minute, that's the narrow way, isn't it? Narrow is the hodos, the way. Jesus said, I am the hodos, the way. John told Gaius, I would that you'd prosper and be in health. Prosper is the word E-U-O-D-O-O. You adio, or you hodos. Prosperity is not money. It's a well way. Health is the word H-U-G-I-A-I-N-O, hugiano. That word hugiano means uncorrupted in word. Same word. If man consists not to wholesome words in the 6th chapter of 1 Timothy, hugiano, wholesome words, uncorrupted in word. John wished for Gaius, the well way, the baptism way. And John the Baptist said, John came preaching the baptism of repentance, which was prepare ye the hodos. Prepare the narrow way. The well way is the narrow way. You've got a bad way. That's a broad way. So Enoch, 7 is the number of baptism. That's the narrow way. That is prepare ye the way. That's the baptism is what it is. And of course, look here, Enoch, when the church is baptized in blood, Enoch's name adds up to 84, that's 7 times 12. The number of the church is 12, and the church has to be baptized in blood, don't they? Huh? Am I going too fast here? Huh? Okay. Now let's go to Methuselah. Almost. Okay. We're at between the A and the T, my English teacher used to say. All right, Enoch. We're at Enoch. Enoch means narrow. When the Bible says train up a child in the way they should go, it doesn't mean to take them to a Baptist or a Church of Christ Sunday school. That's not it. Train up is the word konak. Narrow your children. Put them in a blood baptism. Teach them the truth. Tell them how to tell others the truth so they can be crucified for it and die. That's what we do, isn't it? Somebody shut that door there. Are we still waiting? Oh, am I on? Okay. Train up means to narrow. Now, number 8. The word 8 is the word S-H-E-M-O-N-A-H, Shemona. It comes from the word S-H-A-M-A, and the word Shema is the word hear. Or obey. Hear, obey. 8 is one who hears. Methuselah means man of piercing or man of dart, a one who is pierced with a spear. Who is pierced with a spear? Christ. And he could hear God, couldn't he? 8 comes from the word meaning to hear and to obey. What makes us obey is the piercing. The New Testament Greek word for pierce is P-E-I-R-A, comes from P-E-I-R-A-Z-O, and from that we get the word P-E-I-R-A-S-M-O-S, parosmos, and that's the word for try or trial, the trying of your faith, or the, when Peter said, think it not strange concerning the fiery trial, which is to try you, parosmos. You have to go through the trials and be pierced in order to hear. So 6 is the number of man has to be baptized, Enoch. And what causes us to hear is to go through the continual daily piercing. Well, let's read on down through there. All right, Methuselah. Verse 21, Enoch lived 65 years and begat Methuselah. And Enoch walked with God after he begat Methuselah 300 years and begat sons and daughters. And all the days of Enoch were 365 years. And Enoch walked with God. And he was not, for God took him. And Methuselah lived 187 years and begat Lamech. Now, this word Lamech means purpose. Purpose. The purpose for being pierced and going through a baptism, blood baptism, going down to the waters of God, which is not H2O, going down to the Jordan, the purpose of this, that we, the praise of God, which is the house of God, we're mortals and we're the substitute for Christ. The whole purpose of this is number 10, the word Noah. The purpose of all this is so that we can rest in the things of God. The word Noah means to rest. If we know He's preordained everything, and He says we're to take no thought for our lives, we need to rest in this, don't we? And Noah, and of course here's, I like Lamech, the purpose. Nine, from nine, we get the word teshuva, one of the words repent. Repent has to do with nine in the Scriptures. And if you'll notice, Lamech adds up to nine, and he's the ninth from Adam. I wonder why that happened. Just some reason. Maybe God had something to do with it. Maybe all this is coincidence. That's probably what it is. Yeah, right. Okay. Now. All right, now let's go on to Noah. Noah, let's read on down. Now. All right. Where are we? Methuselah lived after he begat Lamech 780 and 2 years and begat sons and daughters in all the days of Methuselah. What is this lineage? This is the sons of God, isn't it? The 153 times 7. All the days of Methuselah were 969 years. Methuselah, he was the oldest man in the Bible, 969. The Bible says if we obey our father God and our mother, who is Jerusalem, our days will be long upon the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee. That's the first commandment with promise, isn't it? What makes us obey our father God and our mother Jerusalem? When the Bible says honor your father and your mother, it don't mean honor some drunk woman that says that she gave birth to you and she cusses like a sailor. Is that what it's talking about? It's talking about honor God our father, our mother Jerusalem, there in the third chapter of Proverbs. In Galatians, the fourth chapter, when the Bible says Jerusalem is the mother of us all. In Ephesians, the sixth chapter, the first and second verses, children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. But the second verse of the sixth chapter, he says, honor your father and your mother, that thy days may be long upon the earth. This is the first commandment with promise. The 20th chapter of Exodus, when the scripture, that's the Ten Commandments, and the first commandment with promise is honor your father and your mother. Our father's God, our mother's Jerusalem. Who is our brothers and our sisters? Who are the sons of God? Those who do the will of the Father, aren't they? So, your days will be long, Methuselah, when you can hear and obey. So we have to be pierced. And the purpose of that is that we can rest. And see the word Noah? See this word Nuach? If you look at the 23rd chapter of Exodus, and all through the Scriptures, but just one of the places, when the Bible speaks of rest of the Sabbath, it's the word nuach. It means to settle down. We can rest in all the things that God has done because He's done everything from forever to forever. Why are we arguing with God when we have problems? He's ordained it all. He's just baptizing us with all the problems in the world. We need Enoch in our life, don't we? We need narrowing. Now, let's go to the 11th. 11 is amazing. You've got 11 generations in this first, in the sons among the sons of men, among the sons of God. Let's read on down to it. Look at verse 28. And Lamech lived 180 and 2 years and begat a son and called his name Noah, which means rest. The purpose of all this, that we can rest in the things of God, saying, this same shall comfort us concerning our work and toil of our hands because of the ground which the Lord hath cursed. And Lamech lived after he begat Noah 595 years and begat sons and daughters. And all the days of Lamech were 777 years, and he died. And Noah was 500 years old, and Noah begat Shem. Shem is the 11th that the promise goes to. God did not bless. Noah bore Shem, Ham, and Japheth. But Ham and Japheth did not get the blessing of God. The blessing went to the 11th son, the authority of all the world. When they said, let us make us a name, they said, let us make us a Shem. All the earth was of one language and one speech. And among the Jews, when the patriarch put his hand upon one man, it couldn't be withdrawn. God said, blessed be the Lord God of Shem. Japheth the eldest will dwell in the tents of Shem, and Ham will be the servants. Everybody was to serve under Shem. This is the authority, and Shem was second born, wasn't he? Second born.
But he's listed as first.
Huh?
But he's listed as first to show that.
Well, yeah, but the second born is always listed as first. You know, Jacob have I loved, Esau have I hated, and Jacob was second born. That's the way God listed them. Yeah, that's good, isn't it? Now, let's go over to the 11th chapter. We're going to look at the rest of this. Well, let's look and see if, let's just see if Shem, let's establish that Shem, he is the 11th, isn't he? The 11th from Adam. He is the second born. And he has the authority of all the earth, doesn't he? Look here in, of course, we know that in the 10th chapter, that Noah is drinking and his younger son Ham comes in and laughs at him. And look at verse 24 of the 9th chapter. Noah woke from his wine and knew what his younger son had done unto him. So that makes Ham the youngest, doesn't it? And look over at chapter 10 and verse 21. 10 and 21. And unto Shem also, the father of all the children of Eber, the brother of Japheth the elder. Japheth is firstborn. The younger son is Ham, who looked upon his father's nakedness and laughed. That's the youngest. That makes Shem secondborn, doesn't it? Shem is a picture of Abel. He's the picture. I believe all these are secondborns. I can't prove it. I just believe they are. I mean, why would he mess up in that part? God couldn't figure that part out. I can't figure out how to get these people together and start reproducing exactly. Oh, dadgum, you messed up. Is that what you believe? Yes, sir. Yeah, and Seth was his substitute. Now, and he says, look at verse 25 of chapter 9. And he said, cursed be Canaan, a servant of servants shall he be unto his brethren. But look at verse 26. And he said, blessed be the Lord God of Shem. Isn't that great? The 11th. That's the only one he said that about. Blessed be the Lord God of Shem, and Canaan shall be his servants, but so will Japheth. God shall enlarge Japheth, but he will dwell in Shem's tents. That's what it says, doesn't it? He'll dwell in the tents of Shem, and Canaan shall be his servant. And Noah lived after the flood 350 years, and all the days of Noah were 950 years. So the end of the first 11 generations with Shem, isn't it? That's the end of it. Now, let's take up there. We've gone through Adam down through Shem, haven't we? Well, we can't number Shem with the next generation of 11, so we start with Shem's firstborn, Arphaxad. Okay? We're going to start with Arphaxad. Let me put this over here. Don't nobody chew on that. I've got two dogs and they're always chewing on things. Ain't nobody here got a habit of doing that, do you? Okay. If we get Cowboy down here, he'll chew that all to pieces. He'll have Abraham and Noah chewed up. Okay, now, chapter 11. All the earth was one language and one speech. Whenever one man was blessed, that's just like when God blessed Jacob. When Isaac blessed Jacob, Esau got all bent out of shape, even though he'd sold his birthright, and he was just frustrated, didn't know what to do. He was upset, he was angry. But it couldn't be withdrawn. Jacob was second born, wasn't he? When Jacob put his right hand upon the head of his second born, Ephraim. Ephraim was head of the 10 northern tribes, and Ephraim was the second born of Joseph, wasn't he? Joseph was the 11th son. Joseph was the 11th son of Jacob, wasn't he? So 11 and 2 go together. In fact, 11 rules the 12, doesn't it? Huh? Doesn't 11 rule the 12? 11 rules the 12. That's right. Now look here. Here's Gray's Anatomy. Picture Gray's Anatomy. If you're going to go take a medical course, you got to buy one of these. The 11th cranial nerve, or spinal accessory nerve, consists of two parts. The 11th consists of two. It's the spinal nerve. And how many vertebrae in your back? 12. 11 rules the 12, the foundation. This is the foundation of our bodies. 11 rules the 12. Of course, the 8th cranial nerve goes to the ear. Isn't that great? 8 means to hear. 7 goes to the face. The face among the Jews was called the eyes, and Zechariah 4 and 10 says these 7 candlesticks are the eyes of the Lord. So the 7th cranial nerve goes to the face, and that's the eyes. Let's read on here. Let's go over here to 11 and 1. The whole earth was of one language, Sepheth, and one speech, Dabar. Sepheth means lip or boundary line. There were no nations. There was no France. You couldn't go to France and see the Coneheads. Could you? I just thought I'd throw that in there. We're from France. One speech, Dabar. S-E-P-H-E-T-H. Lip. The lip of the United States. I don't need to go into that. I get into Ernest T. Bass every time. His old man Kelsey's woods, old man Kelsey's creek. Atlantic Ocean, Pacific Ocean, old man Kelsey's creek, old man Kelsey's woods. Yeah. I like Ernest T. Bass. He's got more sense than most Baptist preachers I know. Okay. Sepheth. Sepheth means lip. All the earth was of one lip. When you leave the lip of the United States, you go into another language, don't you? That's the word language. And the word Dabar means orderly arrangement. Dabar means, the word Deborah comes from that. It means a word spoken. And it means, this word means orderly arrangement or commandment. All the earth was one commandment. Guess who's executing this? His name is Shem. He's the authority of God upon the earth. He's the 11th and 2, isn't he? He's second born, and he's the 11th from Adam. Let's get into the next section of the 11 generations. Let's see if we come up with any of the same things. I bet we do. What do you bet? This is all the men all the way down from Adam. This is the righteous lineage of God. Now, I got to move over here so you can see that. Y'all, excuse me. Okay, now, let's continue reading. Let's go over here. When they said up here in verse 4, they said, go to, or come, let us build us a city and a tower. Migdal, city was a mother. Let us get our own instructor. Babylon was the mother of harlots, and it started here. And the mother, or the instructor of all idolatry, the instructor of it all was Babylon, and it was built upon a city, a mother, a metropolis, meter, mother, polis, mother of the people, metropolis, a mother of the people. And they said, let us build us a tower, Migdal, M-I-G-D-O-L, that word means pulpit or rostrum. And here's what our message will be. All idolatry in the world that has ever been, that has existed today, this is the mother of harlots. When they said, let us make us a name, it was built on pride or self. The word name is the word Shem. We don't like God's prophet telling us we have to crucify ourselves. We'll make our own Shem. So when Babel started here, they started with a virgin mother, virgin son. She was always worshipped as the mother with a babe in arms. That's called Madonna, or Our Lady the Ruler. That's where Catholicism comes from, or the Christ Mass. They said, let us make us a name, lest we be scattered abroad. I don't have time to go and scatter abroad. Scorpion, scorpios, means to pierce. And evil men were scorpions. When God gives us power over scorpions, the word scorpion, you have a noun and a verb form. The verb form is S-K-O-R-P-I-Z-O. And the scripture says that the hireling cares not for the sheep. He scatters the sheep. That's the scorpizo. It's the verb form of scorpion. The Lord told Ezekiel, you dwell among scorpions, be not afraid of their words. The scorpions of Revelation 9 are false teachers, not helicopters. Golly. I've said it before, if they're helicopters, keep your head down when you're around Paul Crouch. When you're around Kenneth Copeland, their blades will hit you. Let us make us a name, lest we be scattered abroad upon the face of the earth. Now let's finish. Let's go to the second set of 11 generations, okay? We're going to go all the way to Jacob. Verse 10. Where's my stuff here? Here it is. Here's my stuff. Let me get my stuff out. All right. Now, I didn't write down. Hold on. I'm going to give you the meaning of this. I forgot to write it down here. That's 775. Won't take me a second. Y'all not going to leave. 775. Now, all right, Arphaxad. This is the first one in the second set. This is the son of Shem. I believe this is the righteous lineage of God. It continues here. Hold on. Let me get this open here. All right, case I need it. 775. Okay. Son of Noah. Okay. We don't have a meaning that goes with our facts. That's why I didn't put it down. I thought I'd just forgotten. Don't have a meaning. It's of lost origin. Now look here. Verse 10. These are the generations of Shem. Shem was 100 years old when he old and begat Arphaxad 2 years after the flood. And Shem lived after he begat Arphaxad 500 years and begat sons and daughters. We're still in the sons of God, aren't we? And Arphaxad lived 530 years and begat Salah. Now that word Salah is a part of the word Methuselah. Meth meaning man, and Salah means dart or piercing. It means a weapon of war. Or it can mean the branches of a tree, Salah. Now Salah, here's the amount of Arphaxad, here's the amount of Salah. Now I didn't get this out of a book. I actually stayed up all night for 2 nights. I was up to about 4:30 this morning finishing this, and I stayed up all night Friday night doing it. If you want to learn how to do gematria, I can teach you how to do it. It's not really hard. These words, these are, when you're looking let me see if I can show you this. You have to be very careful when you're doing this, because here's a baith. The baith, if you find a baith on here, a baith looks like it's got a little, what they call a tittle right there, a tit or a tittle right there. If that's changed, the baith, if it's rounded, then the baith, when Jesus said, not one jot or tittle, if it's rounded, it becomes a K. A beak becomes a K. Simply the difference between a tittle and rounding it changes the whole meaning of the word. You can't do that. You've got, in fact, if you look at, if I can find it. I had it here somewhere. Well, I'll find it in a minute. You have a resh, an R. You've got a deleth. You've got several of these letters that look nearly just like one another. The resh will be like so. The deleth will be like so. The only difference between them is this right here. You can't change one jot or tittle. You've got a tittle here. You got a hay. If you connect that right here, the H becomes a CH, a ket. That's the tittle right there. You think I'm messing up by leaving a little space between. No, those are different letters when you look at the board. And when Jesus said not one jot, the word jot is the smallest letter of the Hebrew alphabet. It's called a yod. Whenever you have a Y, it's a yod or a jot. Jesus said the smallest letter of the Hebrew alphabet, or one tittle cannot be changed. If you do, you destroy the world. What's the world? It's this great orderly arrangement. You destroy the alphabet of God. Now, let's continue here. All right, let's continue. where were we? Arphaxad lived after he begat Salah 403 years and begat sons and daughters. And Salah lived 30 years and begat Eber. Eber. Here's Eber. And Eber means opposite side of Jordan or in the east. It means across or over on the other side. Now let's go to Peleg. He adds up to 272. Peleg adds up to 113. Let's read Peleg. And Salah lived after he begat Eber 403 years and begat sons and daughters. And Eber lived 430 years and begat Peleg. Now the word Peleg means earthquake or water division. It means to divide the waters. Peleg. 1, 2, 3, 4. God divided the waters, and when he divides the waters, he enters us into the four judgments of God. Now let's continue. Eber lived after he begat Peleg 430 years and begat sons and daughters. And Peleg lived 30 years and begat Reu. Here's Reu. The word Reu comes from Ra'ah, R-A-A-H. And that word R-A-A-H is the word shepherd. A shepherd is called a friend. This means a friend or pasture. And Jesus said, greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends. So when we die, when we tell the truth, we lay down our life for our friends. That adds up to 276. Let's go on down here to Serug, okay? Serug. And Peleg lived after he begat Reu 209 years and begat sons and daughters. And Reu lived 230 years and begat Serug. Serug here. Serug means to intertwine or to wrap together like a wreath. It means to bind together. Now, I know there's a lot of things we're going to discover on this before we get through studying this. Now, where were we? Okay. Yeah, Reu, Serug. And Reu lived after he begat Serug. Of course, Serug adds up to 509. Reu lived after he begat Serug 207 years and begat sons and daughters. And Serug lived 30 years and begat Nahor. Nahor is the grandfather. This word Nahor means to snore or snort. It means nostrils. The number of Nahor is 264. 264, that's what it adds up to. Now, Nahor and Serug lived after he begat Nahor 200 years and begat sons and daughters. And Nahor lived 920 years and begat Terah, Abraham's father. Here's Terah over here. Terah is Terak. It means a place in the desert. His name adds up to 608. Don't seem like any big deal, does it? It is. Now, where are we? I got to go slow and keep up with this. And Terah, look at verse 26, and Terah lived 70 years and begat Abraham, Nahor, and Haran. I had figured up one time, and I'll have to go back and get my figures together, but Abram was the second born. The second birth gets the inheritance of God. This first birth gets nothing, does it? This is a wrestling match between the first and second born, and Jacob and Esau were wrestling when they come out of the womb. Now, I'm going to show you what we're going to do. In order for this to be as it should be, we've got to use Abraham's righteous name, not his unrighteous name, which is Abram. Now, Abram is not a good name, but Abraham is a wonderful name. Abraham means the father of many nations. Abram comes from A-B-R-I-Y-M. Abram, let me write this down. Let me write this down so we can get this. All right, now. Here we go. Abram comes from A-B,
R-I-Y-M, or A-B-I-R-Y-M. Hold on a second. Where are we? Hold on. I got to get it exactly right. Abiram. It comes from Abiram, A-B-I-Y-R-A-M, A-B-I-Y. A-B-I-Y-R-A-M. This word Abiram comes from Ab, meaning father, and the word R-U-W-M. Does anybody remember that word? Room. It's the word that God uses all through the Old Testament scriptures. This means high father. This word Abiram or Abram means high or lifted up father. This word room is the word proud. Six things God hates, seven is abomination. And the first thing on the list is a room look, a high look. Well, God says we have to change your name and give you a righteous name. And what we have to do is add Abraham. And Abraham means father of many nations. It adds up to 248. But let me show you what Abram, the literal lineage of sons of God that God's going to convert, Abram adds up to 243. Abram was the ninth in the second lineage of 11 generations of Shem. The ninth. In mathematical theory, they have something called reducing numbers to their most common number. You take number 243, which is what Abram adds up to, and you add 2 plus 4 plus 3, and you come up with 9. He was the ninth in the lineage of Shem, the second 11 generations. Goodness, it looks like this is going to add up. These are called the patriarchs, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob. Now let's go to Isaac, okay? Now, when you first find Abram or Abraham, his name is changed to Abraham over there in the 17th chapter of Genesis. Now, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob is the righteous patriarchal lineage. How much time do I have? I want to get through this.
17.
Oh, man. I got to hurry. Okay. Now, Isaac adds up to. Isaac means sport or laughter. It adds up to 2:8. Isaac, there's two people here that had to have their names changed, Abram and Jacob. But we have to substitute their righteous names to add them up to righteousness. So we got to put Abraham, which adds to 248. Isaac adds up to 208. If you add 2 plus 0 plus 8, you get 10. Isaac was the 10th in the second in the lineage of Shem. Now, we have to put Israel in. That's Jacob's righteous name. Jacob's name was changed to Israel. If I got time, we'll go back and look at some of those places it was changed. So you'll see this. Jacob's name was changed to Israel. Jacob had 12 sons. This was the 12 tribes of Israel, or the nation of Israel. When I say that a kingdom is a family and a family is a kingdom, this is what it's talking about. God poured out of His Spirit on Israel. That's the one flesh. But in the last days, or the last 2,000 years, He's going to pour out of His Spirit on all flesh, or pas ho, that's the word in John 3:16, pas ho, pas ho, and it's masculine gender, that means the all. It doesn't mean whosoever, it means the all of mankind. And the Jews said if part was saved, the whole was saved. So we got men from every nation, tongue, and tribe. Now, Isaac adds up to 10. Israel is Jacob's not righteous name. But if you take Jacob, Jacob was the 11th in the lineage of Nimrod. Shem. Nimrod wanted to replace Shem. He's the 11th in the place of Shem. So when you add up Jacob, there's the yod, there's the ayin. Look here, look at this. The ayin is the negative particle in the Hebrew, Yahkab. Look here, here it is. Y-A-K-B. Yahkab. There are no vowels in the Hebrew language. So it's Yahab, or if you have Y-T-S, Yitzka. Or Yitzhak, we have talked about Yitzhak Rabin or Yitzhak Shamir. These are names. That is the word Isaac, Yitzhak. Well, the word Jacob is Y. This is not a vowel. The ayin is not. The word ayin means eye. And when the scripture says these seven are the eyes of the Lord, the word eyes is the word ayin. Well, the eye of God is his judgment. Look here. Ayin. A-Y-I-N. When the Bible says the fountains of the great deep are broken up, the word fountain comes from the word ayin. The fountains was the water. That's the judgment of God. This is called the negative particle in the Hebrew. The positive particle is Y-E-S-H. We get the word Yeshua, which is the word Joshua. It's the Old Testament word for Jesus. Yesh and ayin. Now, the negative that determines judgment is the ayin. The value of ayin is seven. The seven candlesticks are the ayin of the Lord. Does that make sense? Yes, sir. It's good, isn't it? When you add up Jacob, it adds up to 182. If you add 8, 1's 9, and 2 is 11. Jacob was the 11th. Now, I'm sure that was probably just all an accident. Now, Jacob was the 11th. Who was the 11th over here?
Shem.
He was second born, wasn't he? Mm-hmm. He became the authority of all the world, didn't he? Who's the 11th over here? Israel. And what is Jacob? Second born. You find the same 11 over here. Now, you realize what God had to do in getting these people to name their children and putting them in the right place. He had to arrange the heated passion between husband and wife. He had to arrange the sexual act. He had to arrange the conception of the particular sperm that was going to fertilize the particular egg. Because a man gives off 400,000 to 600,000 sperm in one sexual act. If it's any other sperm, it will be another individual. I wonder how God controlled that. Well, he's God. He's not Superman. That's what they think he is. I don't believe that predestination. What do you believe this? You think he arranged all of this and he can't arrange his family? And all of these are righteous men here. Well, let's look at Israel. Israel adds up. Israel means Yisrael, means he will rule as God. It comes from Sarah, or Sarah, we would say, which means to prevail as power or a prince. And it comes from El, meaning Almighty. This is the lineage of God. They wouldn't worship anybody but Jehovah. They would not worship Baal, would they? None of these men worship Baal, did they? Let's look at Romans 11 and 4. Romans 11 and 4. I got to get this in before I run out of time. Romans 11 and 4. I'm sitting here talking to y'all, not turning. All right, let's read fourth verse. But what saith the answer of God unto him? Speaking of Elijah, when he said, I've had enough. I have reserved to myself 7,000 men who have not bowed the knee to the image of Baal. These men did not worship Baal, did they? This is the sons of God. What do you think? 45, 700, 357, 210, 136, 214, 84, 784, 90, 58, 605, 338, 272, 113, 276, 509, 264, 608, 248, 208, 541. What do you think that adds up to? That is 7,000 exactly. These men did not bow the knee to Baal. This is the sons of God. These are those who are baptized in the blood. People say, I don't believe in predestination. Can you believe God would make something so magnificent as this? This is from Adam until Israel. Every righteous man. And we are so arrogant. God wouldn't plan who his children are. But he did here, and he numbered them out in their names. Come out to 7,000. Exactly, not 7,000.0122. I will not accept that in gematria. It had to be 7,000 exactly. And I said, Mike, sit down here and check me out. Mike's a mathematician. I said, make sure I have no repeats of letters in there, the wrong numbers. And Mike went over and over this last night, and he said, it's all exactly on target. What a God we have. What events did they... We'll call him Jacob. We'll call our son Seth, Enos. We'll call him Canaan. We'll call him Mahalalel. You think those were accidents? No, because this is God's fish. This is God's air. This is God's baptism, isn't it? And it reduces back to 7, doesn't it? What a great God we have. Let's just look at the last man on the list. I like this. Let me move this out of the way. You can, if you'll start adding up gematria, you're going to come up with magnificent pictures. We're going to come up with 153s in here somewhere. You can just believe that. 153 is the most common number in the Greek language. That's the number of the fist. 1,071 is the number of the heirs. Let's just look at Joseph. Joseph means to add. God had to add Israel to Egypt. He had to add them to Egypt so they could be baptized, didn't he? Joseph is the word Yosef. It adds up to 156. When you add 6 and 5 and 1, you get 12. And Joseph was the 12th. And the second set of 11 of Shem's generation through here. I've got so much more in this. I wish I just had time to go through all this. But let me show you. I want to back up and read to you. I want to show you something that'll be of interest to you. It's about, I know people think those things are accident. You know how many times I added this up? I added it up about 10 times. I went through every one of them. I was up till nearly 5 o'clock this morning. I'd go through and I'd look, check out the Aleph and check out the Death and I'd check out the Mem and I'd check out the Sheen and the Tav and the Aleph and the Noon and the Wav. And the Wav can be Vav. The Mem looks like a cough, but it's because of just a tit or a tittle or a yod that makes the difference. I'd look these up over and over, and then I had Mike lay down on the floor. I said, check me and see if I've got anything wrong. I didn't just add them up at random. I went over and over and over and over. And this is Adam to Israel. Isn't that unbelievable? We have a magnificent God. Take this to your atheist friends. I tell Mike, take this to your math. Mike tutors calculus and trig up at Ball State. I said, take this to your mathematical friends and ask them how God figured out how to do that. Ask him how that accidentally fell together. Tell that to an atheist. Because they didn't bow. These are men of God. That's what they are. What a great... Does that touch y'all's heart like it does mine? What a God we have. Well, what I'm going to do, I'm going to add up all the sons of Jacob. I'm adding up everything and dividing by 157. I've got my calculator. I'm dividing everything by 157. Well, what I'm going to do is... If you go, let me show you something. Let me show you. Let me just show you in studying this. Go over to Matthew, the first chapter. If you're going to add up gematria, and I'm just going to count, I wanted to go ahead and say that. I could have stretched it out, but didn't I go past the, I wanted to get that on the tape. Now, if you go to Matthew, the first chapter, when you're studying gematria, the lineage of Christ, look here. I want to show you this. If you're going to add up any, and I'll give you a copy of the gematria, I'll give you a copy of the numbers. Can you imagine? God had, you know what he had to do? He had to touch the heart of every one of the, he had to stir the passions of the husband and wife, and then he had to put into their head and tell them what to name their children. Didn't he? And he had to tell them exactly how to spell it. They couldn't spell it like we do, you know. Spell it however we wanted to. They had to spell it God's way. Now, where did I say go? Matthew, the first chapter. Look at this. When you're going to add gematria about the lineage of Christ, and I'm going back and I'm going to add all of these up. Believe it or not, I'm going to do this. You got three sets of 14 generations in Matthew, first chapter. But look here at Matthew, the first chapter. The book of the generation of Jesus Christ, the son of David, the son of Abraham, and Abraham begat Isaac. They start with Abraham. But do you want the full lineage? People say, why did God put the lineage of over here in Luke, the third chapter? If you go to Luke, the third chapter, verse 23, and Jesus himself began to be about 30 years of age, being as was supposed the son of Joseph. It was supposed he was the son of Joseph. And it traces back the lineage of Joseph, which was the son of Heli, which was the son of Mathat, which was the son of Levi, which was the son of Melchi, which was the son of Janna, which was the son of Joseph, which was the son of Mattathias. And you're going to find some names are common. Joseph was certainly common. Manasseh was a common name. Enoch was a common name. And this goes all the way back. The one thing that Luke has that Matthew, the first chapter, doesn't have, look over here in verse 34, which was the son of Jacob, which was the son of Isaac, which was the son of Abraham, which was the son of Terah, which was the son of Nahor, which was the son of Saruk, which was the son of Regu, which was the son of Phalak, which was the son of Eber, which was the son of Salah, which was the son of Canaan, which was the son of Arphaxad, which was the son of Sem, which was the son of Noah, which was the son of Lamech, which was the son of Methuselah, which was the son of Enoch, which was the son of Jared, which was the son of Mahalalel, which was the son of Canaan, which was the son of Enos, which was the son of Seth, which was the son of Adam, which was the son of God. See, you get all the way back to God in Luke, the third chapter. You can't get back to God in Matthew, the first chapter. So if you're going to add up the gematria, and I'll teach you how to add the gematria. If anybody wants to help me add all these names up, I want to add every one of them up. Anybody want to help me? It's going to take some work on this because this took me two nights all night long to add this. Let me tell you, I didn't get this out of one of my gematria books. I've got some good gematria books. This is a gematria book here. Numbers and Scripture. Let me read something to you. Let me just read this to you. Some of y'all never heard this. Y'all would like this. Let me just read to you. This goes along with exactness in nature. Let me read this. The grains in Indian corn or maize are set in rows. This is Z.W. Bullinger. He did a numbers study all his life. The grains in Indian corn, what we call Indian maize, are set in rows, generally straight, but in some cases spirally. These rows are always arranged in even numbers in Indian maize, or what we call corn on the cob. Never odd numbers. They range from 8, 10, 12, 14, 16, and sometimes as high as 24, but never 5, 7, 9, 11, and 13, or any odd number of rows. The even number is permanent. Mr. H.L. Hastings tells of one farmer who looked for 27 years and could not find a cob with an odd number of rows. A slave was once offered his freedom if he found a corn cob with an odd number, and one day he found one. But he had found it also sometime before when it was young. Carefully cut out one row and bound it up so that the parts grew together as the corn cob developed and finally presented the phenomenon of having an odd number of rows. This exception proves the rule in an interesting manner. If we notice how the leaves grow up on the stem of a plant, not only is law seen in classifying their nature and character, but number is observed in their arrangement and disposition. Some are placed alternately, some opposite, while others are arranged spirally. But in each case, all is in perfect order. After a certain number of leaves, one will come immediately over and in the same line with the first. In the apple tree, it is the fifth leaf. Apple trees don't grow leaves randomly. In the oak, it's every fourth leaf that lines up exactly with the first. In the peach tree, it's every sixth. In the holly, it is the eighth, but it takes two turns of the spiral before the eighth leaf stands immediately over the first. In the larch, it is the 21st leaf, but it is not until after eight turns of the spiral that the 21st leaf stands directly over the first. We serve a God of order. Those leaves on those trees out there have been magnificently arranged. Predestination? Certainly. God's ordered arrangement? Without a doubt. Your life and mine has been arranged. Every movement of it, every death, every life. Don't we have a God? We don't serve Captain Marvel, or Superman, or Santa Claus, or someone who can implode black holes and explode quasars, and that's all he can do. He can take a stony heart and turn it into a heart of flesh. What a magnificent God we have. I would hate. Free will bores me out of my mind. If I had to go to one of these churches that preaches, well, if you'll only let God in, Canaan, if you'll just let him in, and let's give an invitation and get Canaan saved. Oh, please. Oh, Canaan, you wouldn't accept Christ. You died and went to hell, and you messed up the 7,000. You believe that? And let's, Methuselah, we really want you to come, and we want to sing 25 verses of Just As I Am, and 15 verses of Almost Persuaded, and then sing softly and tenderly for another hour and a half. And maybe Methuselah will come. All that the Father giveth me shall come to me, and he that cometh to me I will in no wise cast out. And of all that he hath given me I shall lose nothing. He's declared the end from the beginning and from ancient times of things that are not yet done. He declared the emotions, the passions. He declared the sperm. He declared, let's call him Peleg. What a name. Who wants to name his kid Peleg? Eber. Of course, that probably sounded real cool to them, you know. Now, I want to give everybody a copy of these, if you can wade through this. And I put all these verses right down here because I want you to see that Jacob is called Israel in Genesis 32 and 28. In 47 and 29, the Bible says that it came time that Israel must die. That was when he was in Egypt. And he had called all his sons around him. And the 49th chapter of Genesis to give them all their blessings. And the first time they were called tribes of Israel was in the 28th verse of the 49th. Chapter of the 28th verse, they were called the 12 tribes there for the first time. And the physician, I just saw this in Genesis 49 and 2, the physicians embalmed Israel. I need to look up embalmed. I just thought, boy, that'd be great, just to study embalmed. I wonder what that means and what the number embalmed adds up to. I look at these things, I gotta add that up. Man, I wonder what that's gonna be. Isn't this great? Don't you like the kind of God that we have? Whew. I got so many more things. We're making copies of these. These are my notes. Here's Adam, Abel, Seth, Abel. I left Abel out. First I added him in because he was substitute, but you can't add him. Oh, by the way, Abel would be the 12th be the 12th in the first lineage that was left out, and Joseph is the 12th in the second lineage that's left out. 11, you remember you had 11 apostles and one was left out? You had 11, you had 12 tribes of Israel and one was left out. And that was the firstborns. God said, give me the firstborns, but instead of the firstborns, I want the Levites, because I can take the tribe of the Levites and scatter them all over Israel. It'll be hard to take the firstborn son out of every family and put him in some kind of priest situation. So I'll substitute the Levites for the firstborn, and I need another tribe. I'm reduced to 11. So he splits Joseph's tribe, gives Ephraim and Manasseh. And it's made up by Ephraim. And Ephraim is the second born of the 11th born of Jacob. Joseph was 11th born. So Shem was the 11th from Adam. He was the second born. He was the authority of God. Jacob was the 11th from Shem. And he was second born. And he was the authority of God. And Joseph was the 11th born. And his second born, Ephraim, headed all the 10 northern tribes of Israel. And it was Ephraim who had the inheritance. Look at that. Let me just look at that and we'll stop. Go over to 1 Chronicles. 1 Chronicles. Here it is right here. So anytime the Bible talks about Ephraim and northern Israel, and Ephraim adds up to 331. If you add 3 plus 3 plus 1, it adds up to 7. I'm sure it was an accident, wasn't it? Ephraim. And Ephraim means double fruit. And we get the word Euphrates from the same word. And goodness, I'll go all night there. Look at 1 Chronicles. Look at 1 Chronicles. Here it is right here. 1 Chronicles 5 and 1. The sons of Reuben, the firstborn of Israel, the firstborn of Jacob. Israel is his righteous name. And for he was the firstborn, but forasmuch as he defiled his father's bed, his birthright was given to the sons of Joseph, the son of Israel. Joseph was the 11th born. And the genealogy is not to be reckoned after the birthright, for Judah prevailed above his brethren, and of him came the chief ruler, but the birthright was Joseph's, not Joseph Smith. Joseph, 11th born, his second born, Ephraim, led the 10 northern tribes. So whenever you find Ephraim in Hosea 13, he says, I'll attack Ephraim like a lion, a leopard, and a bear. He's talking about the nation of northern Israel. And Joseph is a reference to northern Israel. Goodness, I need to quit. I could show you this stuff all day. If those copies don't look real good, get these. The word Judah, the reason I put Ephraim and Judah here just for your information, Joseph was the 11th son of Jacob, and Ephraim had the inheritance, and the West Bank is the land of Ephraim, and they're trying to give away the inheritance of Israel when they give away the West Bank. And they ain't going to do that. The Bible says you can't give it away among tribes. That's why I made the statement several years before Mr. Yitzhak Rabin, Isaac Rabin, Rabbi Isaac is what it means. I made the statement that a Orthodox Jew was going to kill him, because the Numbers, the last chapter, says you cannot trade. You cannot. The land belongs. God said the land is mine. You can't trade it among tribes. You can't sell it. And every 50th year, it went back to the original tribes. You think we're going to give it to a bunch of Philistines? The word Palestinian comes from the word Philistine. No. Ain't going to give it to Philistines. No matter, Mr. Netanyahu better get out of office, because whoever's in there that tries to settle this thing and give that land, they're giving it, he's dead. Dead as sure as there's a God in the sky, and any Orthodox Jew is going to kill any head of Israel that tries to give the land of Ephraim to the Philistines. God says, it ain't going to happen. They do that, you die. I don't want to be premier of Israel. There ain't no way. Even though I am a spiritual Jew, they'll probably call me tomorrow and say, since you're a spiritual Jew, would you like to come and rule us? Ephraim had the birthright. Judah had the king. The scepter will not depart from Judah, but the birthright belongs to Ephraim. So I added Ephraim and Judah in there, and Judah adds up to 30 or 3. And Judah means to use the hand to revere or worship, to bemoan or confess. And we as priests of God and kings, we're going to bemoan and confess Christ. I don't have time to go there. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for letting us see this greatness that you are as a magnificent God. God, help me to find 153 in the Old Testament. Because, God, all that does is affirm our faith. What a great God we have. We are your fish, your heirs. This overwhelms us. It puts us on our face, God. Help us to understand your truth more every day, God, and we'll give you the glory for everything, Lord, because we deserve none. To see you magnificently arrange not just these men and their names, but the passions of their parents on an exact night or day, Lord. You are truly God. And Lord, we'll continue to praise you if you give us strength. And you will continue this work that you've begun in us until the day of Jesus Christ. We bow to your will in Christ's name. Amen.